So good morning, students. We are going to see a topic today about malignant melanoma. So malignant melanoma is a type of skin cancer. So that develops from the pigment producing cells known as melanocytes. Okay. So that is a basic origin of the malignant melanoma. So in introduction, it is a malignant tumor arising from epidermal melanocyte, which is most aggressive cutaneous malignant tumor. So it is of neural crest origin. So in neural crest, ectodermal neural crest origin. So it is 20 times more commonly seen in whites than in blacks. So in black origin, the incidence is less. In white origin, the incidence is more. So its incidence is equal in both sexes. Its incidence is increasing over the years of time. So initially it will appear as a small mole. Gradually it increases in size over the period of time. Like its years together, it will increase in size. So the incidence also, it will be found more in adults. In older adults. So 5% of skin cancers are melanomas. It is most common in Queensland, Australia, Auckland, and New Zealand. So Melanoblast is the primitive cell derived from neural crest. Melanocyte, the cell which synthesizes melanin and is located in the basal layer. So melanocyte, the basal layer is 1:10. So the melanocyte is to the ratio between the melanocyte and the basal layer is 1:10. Melanophores are the pigment melanin carries through dendrites into the epidermis, and melanophages are macrophages having melanin pigment. Melanoblasts and melanocytes contain DOPA oxidase enzyme and synthesize melanin. So they show positive DOPA reactions. So melanophores and melanophages show negative DOPA reaction, and melanin synthesis is controlled by melanocytes stimulating hormone. So ACTH and sex hormones. So these are the mechanism behind the melanoma formation. So in women, they commonly occur in the legs, while in the men, they more commonly occur in the back. So the common thing is most 25% of the melanoma arises from the any previous mole. So that is the characteristic of melanomas. So that only we are going to see the sites. So in head and neck, the distribution throughout the body, in the head and neck, it's 25% incidence is there. And in the trunk, either in the front and the back, back is more common actually. Back is more common in males mainly. So in the trunk, 25%, and the lower limb, 25%. So in women is more, the incidence of occurring is more common in lower limb. So it is 25%. The upper limb is 11%, and other sites other than these regions, other sites 14%. So in females, leg is the commonest site, and in males, the front or back of the trunk. So in the Bantu tribe, sole is the commonest site. So it is a unique location. It is a rarest location. Sole is the commonest site in the Bantu tribe. So other sites like eyes, in eyes, iris we can see, in ciliary body and choroids we can see in the eyes. So in the mucocutaneous junction, anorectal region, and genitalia. So these are the commonest mucocutaneous junction. So in the head and neck, we can see in meninges, oropharynx, nasopharynx, and paranasal sinus. So the primary cause of melanoma is ultraviolet exposure in those with the lower level of the skin pigment melanin. The ultraviolet light may be from the sun or other sources such as tanning devices. So people who use tanning devices are also has the risk factors. Same time, those with many moles and a history of affected family members and poor immune function are at the greater risk. So a number of rare genetic conditions such as xeroderma pigmentosa also increase the risk. So diagnosis is mainly based on the biopsy. So this is the short illustration of the disease melanoma. So using sunscreen and avoiding ultraviolet light may prevent melanoma. So melanoma is the most dangerous type of skin cancer. So globally in 2012, newly occurred diagnosed patient is 232 patients around the worldwide. And in 2015, there were 3.1 million people have active disease, and which resulted in around 60,000 deaths throughout the world. So Australia and New Zealand have the highest rate of melanoma in the world actually. So there are also high rates in Northern Europe and Northern America also. So melanoma has become the more common since in the 1960s, and areas most populated by European descent, they have more incidence. Okay. So coming to the risk factors, exposure to sunlight, exposure to mainly ultraviolet light, more common in white skinned than the black skin. I already said more common in white skinned individual than the black. So it's 20 times more common in white skin. So ethnic factors and social economic status and lifestyle and climate. So this decides the risk factor for an individual. So ethnic factor like white. So black has the less risk factor. So same time, high social economic factors has the more risk factor. Okay. And lifestyle and climate. So in hot climate, where ultraviolet rays is more prone. Okay. So what is the ultraviolet radiation wavelength? So it is 200 to 180 nanometer. 200 to 180 nanometer. It is the risk factor for ultraviolet radiation for damaging the DNA of an individual. So when there is absorption is there, it damages very and causes the risk factor. Okay. So the other risk factor like albinism. So as I said already, xeroderma pigmentosa. So it has a risk, increased risk factor is 1000. So it is an autosomal recessive disease with abnormality in the chromosome 9q with defect in DNA excision repair mechanism. So it causing formation of aberrant nucleotide causing ultraviolet rays. So the intolerance caused by the ultraviolet rays and so it causes erythema, pigmentation, photophobia and premature skin aging and multiple malignancy with 60% mortality at the age of 20. So other risk factors like junctional nevus, familial dysplastic nevus syndrome, sporadic dysplastic nevi. So it has 10% risk. And large congenital nevi, so larger than 20 centimeter. So these are congenital nevi. We can see in patients will be having a congenital nevi. So it will tend to develop increase in size. So when it is larger than 20 centimeter by birth only, so it is the risk factor for malignant melanoma. So and family history of melanoma. So 10% through chromosomes 1p, 6q and 7 and 9. So these are the chromosomal aberration. The family members will carry this type of chromosome aberration, like 1p, 6q, 7 and 9. So they are often prone for developing malignant melanoma. So they often present with multiple primary melanomas associated with dysplastic nevus. So here, history of earlier skin cancer other than melanoma. So in some individuals will be, there will be earlier skin cancer like squamous cell carcinoma, basal cell carcinoma, like that. In such patients, the history of they are more prone for developing malignant melanoma. So the patient who are on immunosuppressive drugs or after renal transplant or non-Hodgkin lymphoma. So in most skin, in overall, the persons who are receiving immunosuppressant drugs following for any post-op transplant, any renal transplant or liver transplant or cardiac transplant like that, such patients have the tendency to develop the most common disease which are more prone for developing in such immunosuppressive individuals who are receiving immunosuppressive drugs is skin cancer. So in skin cancer, malignant melanoma is more common among them. Okay. So these are the risk factors what we discussed. So exposure to sunlight, the exposure to ultraviolet light, more, it's more common. So the wavelength of the ultraviolet rays is 280 to 315 nanometer. Okay. So it is the amount of wavelength needed for an ultraviolet to damage the DNA. Okay. So coming to ultraviolet radiation, I want to detail more. The ultraviolet radiation from the tanning beds increases the risk of melanoma. So than the sunlight, ultraviolet from sunlight, the ultraviolet radiation from the tanning beds increase the risk of melanoma. So the International Agency of Research on Cancer finds that tanning beds are carcinogenic to human, and that people who begin using tanning device before the age of 30 are 75% are more likely to develop melanomas. So those who work in aeroplanes also appear to have an increased risk, believed to due to greater exposure to ultraviolet rays. So in ultraviolet B light, okay, ultraviolet B light, which is the wavelength between 315 and 280 nanometer from the sun, is absorbed by the skin cell DNA and result in a type of direct DNA damage. So called cyclobutane pyrimidine dimers, CPDs. Okay. So the thymine cytosine or a cytosine thymine bases within a DNA strand, somewhat similar to ultraviolet B rays and ultraviolet A light and from the sun, and forming and from tanning beds can also be directly absorbed by skin DNA. So at about 10 to 1000 fold lower efficiency than ultraviolet B is absorbed. So exposure to ultraviolet radiation, ultraviolet A and ultraviolet B, is one of the major contributors to the development of melanoma. So occasional extreme sun exposure causing sunburns is cause related to melanoma. So these are the thing. So both ultraviolet A and ultraviolet B radiation. So ultraviolet A, the wavelength between 400 and 350 nanometer. So ultraviolet B is 315 and 280 nanometer. So ultraviolet B is more risky. So overall the malignancy which spread from mother to the fetus is a lymphosarcoma and melanoma. So now we are coming to the classification. So this is the very important classification we are going to see. It is a Breslow's classification. It is the classification is done in 1970. So it is based on the thickness of invasion measured by optical micrometer, most important prognostic indicator until nodal spread. So it is measured, the thickness is measured by optical micrometer. So Breslow classification 1 is less than 0.75 mm, and its classification 2 is between 0.76 and 1.5 mm. So classification 3 is 1.51 mm to 4 mm. So classification 4, the tumor which comes more than 4 mm. So here we can see the Breslow's depth. We can see the anatomy of the skin first. So skin, epidermis, dermis, and subcutaneous fat. Okay, so dermis is again divided into papillary dermis and reticular dermis. So here we can see the depth. If the tumor is it's less than 1 mm. See, we can see it's less than 1 mm is classification 1. So between 2 is the more than 1 and 2 mm, and classification 3 is 1.5 mm to 4 mm. So here we can see and more than 4 mm. So the size of melanoma and excision of margin. So excision of margin, it's a margin means it is the melanoma what we excise will be having a tumor free margin. So that is the main thing we have to remember while a surgeon performs a surgery. So the excision should be for a melanoma in situ, where the melanoma doesn't spread up to 1 mm. So here 5 mm margin can be done, is required for a tumor free margin. So excision margin should be 5 mm. So for melanoma less than 1 mm, the margin should be 1 cm. So it's 1 cm. So if melanoma is 1 and 2 mm, the excision margin should be 1 to 2 cm. If the melanoma is 2 to 4 mm, the excision margin should be 1 to 2 cm. And the size of melanoma is greater than 4 mm, or approximately it's 5.5 cm, the excision margin should be 2 cm. So if we are creating a 2 cm margin, there will be a huge raw area will be there. So in a huge raw area, if presence is there, then we will go for skin grafting or a flap. So what is graft? What is flap? Graft means which contains only the epidermis. So flap means which contain graft contain both epidermis and dermis. Okay, so it depends on the full thickness or partial thickness. Okay, so if it's a flap means it will have a vascular supply. So that is flap. So if there is a huge raw area, then the closure with the wound cannot be left open, because it will give again poor scarring will be there and the wound healing will be very poor. So we will plan for a skin grafting or flap. So previously we saw Breslow's classification. Now this is Clark's level. So level 1 will limit up to the skin and epidermis. So level 2, the superficial part of the dermis. So level 3 is the middle part of the dermis. So level 4, we can see the deeper part of the dermis. So if the melanoma, malignant melanoma will reach, is reaching up to subcutaneous fat, then it is level 5. So the differential diagnosis of a melanoma. So it's seborrheic keratosis. So dermatofibroma. So we can see dermatofibroma protuberans and pigmented BCC. So basal cell carcinoma and pigmented SCC, pigmented squamous cell carcinoma, nevus. We can see congenital nevus also in many kids also we will used to see. And sebaceous epidermal nevus and Kaposi's sarcoma and mycosis fungoides. So these are some of the differential diagnosis of malignant melanoma. So other DDs like cutaneous hemangiomas. So hemangioma means vascular malformation. So the hemangioma has a tendency to regress. So in the kids, if a child birth with a cutaneous hemangioma is there, it will regress by after when the child grows up. So that is also a differential diagnosis for suspecting malignant melanoma. Then certain skin adnexal tumor. Then solar keratosis. Some patient develop solar keratosis due to prolonged exposure to sunlight. And pyogenic granuloma. So it is the word pyogenic means you know that it is an infection. So it present as the differential diagnosis for malignant melanoma. Then cutaneous angiosarcoma. Okay. So now we comes to the clinical types. So what are the types? The common types are superficial spreading, nodular superficial spreading melanoma, nodular melanoma, lentigo maligno melanoma, and acral lentiginous melanoma. So these are some types of melanoma. So we are going to see superficial spreading. So superficial spreading is the more common. More common, it's incidence up to 70% among all melanomas, all types of melanoma. So it occurs in any part of the body with variegated irregular look. So it has more radial growth and better prognosis. Even though if it is more common, so among all the types of melanomas, it has a good prognosis. So it has more radial growth and prognosis due to its presence in the superficial. There won't be any deep penetration or infiltration. So it commonly arises from a pre-existing nevus. So in men, it's common in the back, and in women, it's common in the leg. So already said, in women, the more common location is leg, and in men, it's common in the back. So melanoma, so then so 70% it is a superficial spreading melanoma. Then 12 to 25% is a nodular melanoma. So nodular melanoma is a more aggressive. So this superficial spreading melanoma has good prognosis, but the nodular melanoma it's a more aggressive, so that the prognosis will be poor. So it is seen in younger age group. So as we say, it already in the introduction I said that melanoma's incidence is more common with the older adult. So when these melanoma found in the younger age group, it is more younger age group, then it is found to be more aggressive. So it occurring in any part of the body. So it has more vertical growth. How the superficial spreading has the more tendency for radial growth, but in nodular melanoma, it has a more vertical growth. Vertical growth means the growth will go this way. Radial means this way. Okay, this is horizontal, this is vertical. Okay, so in the site wise, the nodular melanoma is more common in mucosa and mucocutaneous junction, and it presents as uniform nodular like that and more vertical growth. So the nodal spread is more common. So as we said already, it is more aggressive. The nodal spread is common here. So because of the nodal spread, it indicates that it spread to the regional lymph nodes. So so that's why it has got poor prognosis. So the malignant melanoma usually appears as de novo and common in men and common in trunk and head and neck. So now we come to the third type of malignant melanoma, that is lentigo maligna melanoma. So it accounts for 7 to 15% of overall melanoma. It is less common and least malignant. So here we see the first one, superficial spreading, has a good prognosis and have a radial growth, and here nodal melanoma we have, it has vertical growth and mostly found in younger individual group and more aggressive because it has its tendency to spread to nodular spread. So it has got poor prognosis, and here we are seeing lentigo maligna melanoma. The incidence only is very less common. It accounts for only 7 to 15%, and same time it is least malignant. So that is the characteristic feature for lentigo maligna melanoma. So it occurs in the older age group and common in face. So we can see Hutchinson melanotic freckles. Freckles mean the brown color discoloration, mostly common found in European ethnic persons. So it from that the melanoma arises. It is Hutchinson's melanotic freckle. It is also slow growing. So when it is a slow growing tumor, so it can be treated or excised, and the result prognosis will be very good. So brown macule and lentigo, and common in face, neck and hands. So mostly found in upper limbs and face and neck. So common in elderly women. So women and lentigo maligna is in in situ type. So in situ means it won't spread to the other region, surrounding regions, and same time the spread will be within contained within the cells. So it is lentigo maligna is in situ type. Then acral, the fourth form is acral lentiginous melanoma. So it accounts for 5%. So it occurs in palms, sole and subungual region. Subungual means below the nail, finger nail, no? So that is subungual region. So common, it's more common is found in Japanese. So it has got a poor prognosis. So this also got a very poor prognosis. So only melanomas which got some good prognosis, superficial spreading melanoma and lentigo maligna melanoma. So the poorer prognosis is nodal melanoma and acral lentiginous melanoma. So the acral lentiginous melanoma usually attains larger size, and nodular type with more vertical growth faces is one of the characteristic features, and it is common in Africa and Asia, and it is less common in whites, and it is often flat irregular macule, and it mimics fungal infection and pyogenic granuloma. So already said the differential diagnosis for malignant melanoma because of this one, the acral lentiginous melanoma will present like a pyogenic granuloma. So we can see in the sole, mainly main thing is soles is the rarest, because the moles present in the soles will be less. So acral lentiginous melanoma are prone to develop in the soles in the subungual regions and palms and soles. Just remember palms and sole and subungual regions. Okay, so a melanotic melanoma. So this is the worst type of among the all melanoma. So because of the undifferentiation and tumor cells lose their because of the poor differentiator. If always when tumor is well differentiated, then there will be a good prognosis for excision will be there. So we can excise very clear margin should be given, can be given, and it will gives a good prognosis. Whenever there is a poorly differentiated carcinoma and undifferentiated, that is, it will be a worst type. So the tumor cells lose their capacity to synthesize melanin. It present as rapidly progressive pinkish flesh tumor. It may mimic soft tissue sarcoma, and it needs markers like S100 and HMB45 for diagnosis. These are tumor markers, S100 and HMB45 for diagnosis. Then the other variant of melanoma is desmoplastic melanoma. So it have high affinity for perineural invasion, and it is common in head and neck with higher recurrence rate. So it is a melanotic melanoma with thicker lesion carrying poor prognosis due to neural invasion. So it has a thicker lesion carrying very poor prognosis due to neural invasion. So we will discuss the types in short. So clinical type, superficial spreading melanoma, it is 70% and it accounts for most common, and it is 70% and it occurs in any part of the body with irregular look, and it have the more radial growth and a tendency to develop from the pre-existing nevus. So nodular melanoma more aggressive because of the tendency to spread through nodal spread. So and it has got poor prognosis. And then lentigo maligna melanoma, it accounts for only 7 to 15%. It occurs in the older individual and it is a slow growing tumor. So that's why it's given a good prognosis. And lentigo maligna is in the in situ type. So what is in situ means? In situ and invasive. In situ means the cancer cells doesn't cross the basement membrane. So if the tumor invades the basement membrane means it is invasive. So that is the main difference between in situ and invasive. So on acral lentiginous melanoma, so it occurs in, it has a poor prognosis and it occurs in the, remember, palms, sole and subungual region. So and then amelanotic melanoma, it is the worst type and because of the undifferentiation tumor and cell lose their capacity to synthesize melanin. So it mimic as a soft tissue sarcoma and needs, it requires a tumor marker like S100 and HMB45 for diagnosis. And then desmoplastic melanoma, it also has a poor prognosis because these melanomas will present with a thicker lesion and has the tendency to perineural invasion, affinity for perineural invasion. So most important characteristic features of a melanoma. So here we comes to the interesting part of melanoma is the characteristic features, which is a unique feature for melanoma. We can see, we can remember that in the mnemonics A, B, C, D, E. So A is asymmetry. So we can see asymmetry, how a normal has a, it is symmetrical. There is no asymmetry in that. Here we can see asymmetrical melanoma. Big borders will be there, will be seen. And then border irregularity, we can see border irregularity. See in the right side, we can see a normal one with a normal border, that is with a uniform border. That is, we can see here border irregular border is there. So it is also suspicious. Whenever you see a patient with a mole or navius or a growing mole or increasing the mole with increasing in size, we can suspect, we have to compare with the A, B, C, D, E. Okay. So A is asymmetry, B is border irregularity, and C is color variation. We can see a normal color and we can see the same mole with different colors. So a darker and lighter and variation is there, and diameter. So and the increase in size. So the diameter is not equal. See, okay, here equal diameter is there. Here the diameter varies with the vertical and horizontal. Okay. And then elevation. Final is elevation. So here the diameter, it's increases more than 6 mm. So it is again suspicious for 6 mm means more than 0.5 cm. Okay, it's a 0.6 cm, which again suspicious for melanoma. So melanoma has a characteristic feature, asymmetry, border irregularity, and color variation, and diameter greater than 6 mm. And elevation. So the vertically, it will the melanoma will tend to grow elevation. So spread. So through lymphatic, it spreads to regional lymph nodes either by permeation or by embolization. Okay. So and in transit nodules or satellite nodules are seen in the skin between the primary lesion and the regional lymph nodes area, and is due to retrograde spread to dermal lymphatics. So through blood, it spread to the metastasis. It spread to the lungs, so through blood it spread to the other organs like the metastatic organs like the lungs, liver, brain, skin, bones, and secondaries are typically black. So we can see black color secondaries. So then melanoma in choroid, eye, has got better prognosis.
Because as there are no lymphatics in the eye, so melanoma in choroid has got better prognosis. And the also the spread is delayed, and sometimes primary is very small and unnoticed in the anus and subungual region. So when the primary is very small and unnoticed, the prognosis will be very poor due to the patient doesn't notice. That is the main thing. So they present with features of secondaries only. So in such condition, the primary will be hidden and the presentation will be the secondaries only will be seen first. So blood spreading melanoma. So in brain, the features will be the patient will present with convulsions, localizing features like headache, and then raised intracranial pressure, like the vomiting will be present and headache will be there for the patient, and the dizziness will be there. So convulsion, epilepsy will be the seizure activity will be there. So that is the feature when there is a blood spreading melanoma to the brain. So when it spread to the lung, it present as a cannonball secondaries and pleural effusion and hemoptysis, and then chest pain and chronic cough. So this again feature for one when it spread to the lung. So when there is a spread to the liver, the patient will present with massive ascites and massive liver and ascites. So when the melanoma spread to the skin, there will be a cutaneous nodule, often pigmented. So when the spread is to the bone pain is there, pathological fracture is there, we have to suspect for malignant melanoma. So and then other neurological presentation like paraplegia, neurological deficits in spine metastasis, and extensive visceral involvement causing melanuria. So common sites of occult melanoma. So when the word occult means it is hidden. So when the common sites is the hidden region, like the patient can't able to notice. Okay, so regions like scalp, anus, genitalia, eye, and external auditory canal, adrenal medulla, and nail bed, subungual. So the staging of the malignant melanoma. So staging 1A, it goes with the thickness less than 0.75 millimeter, and it's stage 1B, thickness between 0.76 and 1.5 millimeter. Stage 2A, thickness between 1.51 to 4 millimeter. Stage 2B, thickness more than 4 millimeter. So this is staging of melanoma. And stage 3A, any of the above plus nodes. So it any of the above means stage 1A, 1B, 2A and 2B plus nodes less than 3 centimeter. Presentation will be nodes less than 3 centimeter. So stage 3B, any of the above plus nodes more than 3 centimeter. And stage 4, any of the above plus any node plus distant metastasis like brain, liver, eye, skin, bone, like that. Any distant metastasis presentation will be. So now we come to the treatment part. So treatment part, first we will investigate. Investigation should be done to confirm our diagnosis. Then we will plan for surgery. Okay. So in the investigation, incision biopsy. So first incision biopsy should be done. Incision biopsy can be done for a larger melanoma. Only a part of the lesion will be excised. So the other lesion will be left, and for after confirming the diagnosis, we will go for again a surgery. So then excision biopsy of primary. So it is done only with the melanoma with 2 millimeter margin with the deeper fatty tissue. So one should avoid using cautery and avoid crushing the tissues as much as possible. To prevent the spread, we have to avoid using cautery and avoid crushing the tissue. Okay, so it will cause sealing. So instead of excision biopsy, punch biopsy is done in case of larger primary tumor very close to organs like pinna and eye, nose, like that. So punch biopsy assess the depth thickness of the lesion. Punch should be done at the more elevated part of the lesion to get proper depth. So the elevated part should be removed with the proper depth. And then it is done, this investigation, the incision biopsy and excision biopsy of primary and punch biopsy is done from the lesion. And then if there is a spread is there to the regional lymph node, then we will plan for FNAC of the lymph node. Even excision biopsy of the lymph node can be done. Then ultrasound abdomen, it have to look for the screening workup. For any liver secondaries is there, we have to do ultrasound abdomen. Usually it present with ascites and huge hepatomegaly occurs actually. And then we have to look for chest X-ray. Any lung presentation is there, we have to do a screening chest X-ray to look for secondaries in the lung, mainly cannonball appearance. And then HRCT of chest is ideal, because chest X-ray we cannot able to find any metastatic lesion. So high resolution contrast CT. Okay, high resolution CT is more ideal in looking for lung lesions, to working up lung lesion. So relevant other methods depending on site and spread. Example, CT scan of head. If your presentation is a patient with a suspicious melanoma and present with a recent seizure episodes, then we have to look for secondaries in the brain. So we have to do CT scan of head and chest, abdomen and pelvis. So urine for melanuria signifies advanced disease, that is visceral metastasis. And then sentinel lymph node biopsy. So sentinel lymph node biopsy means the sentinel lymph node is a lymph node which drains the organ, which is the first lymph node to drains the any nearby lesion. Okay. So sentinel lymph node biopsies. As I said already, if we suspect for a lymph node in the region is there, then we will plan for FNAC. Same time, excision biopsy also can be done. So excision biopsy, we will excise not all the lymph node, only the sentinel lymph node. The sentinel lymph node is the one which drains the first lymph node to drain the any regional organ. Okay. So the tumor markers. So coming to tumor markers, this is the investigation done for finding whether it is malignant melanoma. So tumor markers like LDH and melana A and S100, tyrosinase and HMB45 are the tumor markers used. The human melanoma black 45, that is HMB45, is a monoclonal antibody against specific antigen PMEL17, so present in melanocytic tumors. So HMB45 has got 92% sensitivity. So and then MRI of the area. So MRI of the area also can be done for any regional spread. So then PET scan is positron emission tomography scan to detect the spread in selected patients only. Any distant spread is there, we can do positron emission tomography. Because of the availability is less, it is and also expensive. We can do when only in selected patients. So tumor markers for melanoma. So tumor markers like melan A and S100 and HMB45. It is otherwise known as human melanoma black 45 and LDH. For primary, so this is a treatment. Coming to the treatment for primary tumors, Handley is wide local excision. So it is also known as WL, wide local excision. It's a wide excision with clearance of margin as well as depth. So both the depth and the margin should be cleared. Clearance margin used in the older days is 3 to 5 centimeters. So minimum to more than 2 centimeter margin for a invasive malignant melanoma. If the primary area is wide and deep, then amputation with the one joint above is done. So when there is a wide deep infiltration of the melanoma is there, then amputation is the choice for surgery. So in fingers and toes, disarticulation is required. So, and melanoma in anal canal may require APR, abdominal peritoneal resection. So, enucleation of the eye in case of melanoma in the eye. So, melanoma in pregnancy is treated with termination of the pregnancy and specific therapy for melanoma. So, pregnancy should be postponed for 2 years. So, for lymph node secondaries, in a clinical palpable lymph node, FNAC of lymph node is done. So, in case of spread, the regional block dissection is done. So, for a curative, for only for diagnostic purpose, we will do FNAC and sentinel lymph node biopsy. For therapeutic purpose, if there is in case of spread, a regional block dissection should be done. Example, like ilioinguinal or axillary or neck region is done. Block dissection is done. So once FNAC shows positive lymph node, 5 years survival rate reduces to 50%. So when there is a spread to the regional lymph node, the survival is reduced to 5 year survival is reduced to 50%. So in a fixed lymph node, only chemotherapy is the treatment because it is inoperable. So when the lymphatic spread is fixed, it becomes as an inoperable condition, and only we have to go for palliative chemotherapy. So the surgery is deferred. So then lymphatic mapping and sentinel lymph node biopsy. It is introduced by Dr. Donald Morton in the year 1970. So radioactive colloid is injected around the primary site. This is the method of sentinel lymph node biopsy. So radioactive colloid is injected around the primary site, and lymphoscintigraphy is done using handheld gamma camera to visualize the micro metastasis in the nodal field. So if there are micro metastasis, then regional block dissection should be done. So therapeutic lymph node dissection, I already said therapeutic lymph node dissection is done after confirming the regional lymph node metastasis. So prophylactic regional block dissection which was previously advocated is now controversial. So only if there is a confirmation of the regional lymph node spread, we will go for block dissection. Prophylactic regional block dissection is now controversial. So but still used in many centers, elective lymph node dissection is done under when tumor is more than 1 to 4 mm. So and the management for unknown primary, so only the patient will present with secondaries, so the primary will be unknown. So in such condition, it accounts for 2%. So presenting as a nodal secondaries by nodal radical dissection at the region with adjuvant chemotherapy, so they have better prognosis than with the known primary. So adjuvant chemotherapy with the secondaries by treated by nodal radical dissection. So patient should be monitored and evaluated to identify the primary site during every follow-up. Once the primary is identified, it is treated accordingly depending on its location. So for local regional melanoma, local recurrence is one which recurs within 5 cm radius of the primary tumor in the skin or in the deep subcutaneous tissue. So it is called local recurrence. So within the 5 cm radius, it will recur. So the risk of local recurrence is 0.2% if primary tumor is less than 0.75 mm and 2% if it is between 0.75 to 1.5 mm and it is 6% if it is 1.5 to 4 mm and it is 12% if it is more than 4 mm. So the risk for local recurrence. So when there is a distant metastasis, distant spread, as I already said, skin, bone, lung, brain and liver. So in such state, the plan is like a melanoma is, when there is a distant spread is formed or suspected, CT scan on the chest and the CT abdomen and pelvis are needed to confirm the distant spread. So brain, lung and liver are the most common sites. So skin, bone and GI, other visceral part are less common sites. So but melanoma is one of the commonest tumor to spread to the intramural GI. So to present as intussusception. So from the skin, it spreads to the intraneural JAT, and the presentation will be intersusception will be the presentation. So distant spread went from or suspected CT scan or head and chest and abdomen and pelvis are needed. So mainly, as I already said, for selected patients we can do PET scan, positron emission tomography, and tumor markers are also should be done for for the diagnosis. It is very useful. So chemotherapy and immunotherapy is the main treatment for the patient with distant metastasis. So isolated lung or liver metastasis can be resected. So isolated liver, like one lobe of the liver can be resected. Like if only one lung is involved, that segment of the lung or the whole lung is being removed. And then radiotherapy is useful for bone and brain secondaries. So controlling the disease will be with the radiotherapy when there is a brain and bone secondaries. Anyway, the prognosis will be finally poor actually. Then stereostatic program using gamma knife is better for brain secondaries. For giving a betterment of life for the patient, we can do such surgery till the survival will be very good. Chemotherapy for melanoma. So indications are secondaries, when there is secondaries in the lungs, liver, bones. So and adjuvant chemotherapy is indicated after surgery for melanoma, and usually it is given intravenous. So the drugs used for chemotherapy is diethyltriamine, immunocarboxamide. So that is DTIC, and then melphalan, that is phenylalanine mustard, and melphenan for melanoma. Okay, that is melphenan, and carboplatin. These are platin derivatives. Carboplatin and bin design, and the CVD design. That is CVD is cisplatin, vinblastine, and dacarbazine. So the other chemotherapy, and when coming to immunotherapy, it is done using specific tumor antibodies like BCG and levomisole and cornibacterium parvum and alpha interferon, interleukins, and tumor vaccines is tried with some success rate up to 40% in advanced melanoma. So biochemotherapy is combination of CVD with interferon alpha and interleukin 2. So these are the type of immunotherapy biologically done. So interferon alpha is a cytokine which is anti angiogenic and stimulator of natural killer NK cells, and the dose is 20 millimole per meter square. So it is administered IV 3 times a week for 4 weeks, then maintenance dose of 10 mole per meter square subcutaneously 3 times a week for 1 year. So severe myelodepression and fulminant liver necrosis are the toxicity, and so often dose is reduced to 3 millimole per meter square 3 times weekly for 2 years. So GM2 ganglioside based vaccine, so it stimulates production of IgM antibodies, and melasin, it contains melanoma cell lysate and cancer vaccine. So other immunotherapy like the GM2 ganglioside, melasin, and cancer vaccine. So cancer vaccine are 3 vaccines under the trial at present. So endo lymph therapy, so it can be done to control the disease in the nodes using radioactive iodine. So iodine 131 or P32. So with ultrafluid lipodol along with lymphangiography, so it can be done. So then targeted therapy, so signal transduction inhibitor therapy, so it is done with So coming to the targeted therapy, signal transduction inhibited therapy. So these are recent advances in treating malignant melanoma. So a targeted therapy, signal transduction inhibited therapy like vemurafenib, dabrafenib, and trametinib are signal transduction inhibitor. So then oncolytic virus therapy also nowadays done. And monoclonal antibody therapy are different targeted therapy. So these are targeted therapy. It is done. It's a recent advance in treatment. So when coming to the prognosis of the melanoma, as already said, when it is identified earlier, before that it's spreading to the other regional region spread, the prognosis of the melanoma will be very good. So it is not. It is not good when it is a aggressive tumor. So at same time, older age group have worse prognosis, and in sex wise, females have slow and better prognosis. So extremity melanoma has better prognosis than head and neck. So as when extremity, if it's present, means it can be treated with disarticulation. So when it's a deeper spread also is there, extremity melanoma can be treated very good and has a better prognosis than head and neck. So follow up therapy in melanoma. So in stage 1 and stage 2 disease, after treatment, follow up is done at 6 months interval for 3 years. So when there is a disease free interval for up to 3 years, then the patient does not require more extra follow up. So it is done by clinical examination and the markers like LDH assay and the UST abdomen and chest X-ray for 3 years. In the 6 months interval for stage 1, stage 2 disease, the follow-up is done with the clinical examination, LDH assay, and the UST abdomen and chest X-ray. In stage 3 disease, PET scan, CT of head, and the chest and abdomen are indicated. So this is the malignant melanoma. So we the class has been ended.